seems the backing track has ended. Fantastic. Lovely to be back here for a Lick Library Live from my home. Hope you're all doing absolutely fantastic. I'm just going to check in on the chat. I can see some familiar names there. You've got Kate, how are you doing? Kim, hello. Hemelstrap, good to see you. Mark, I've got some names there which I wouldn't want to. From Denmark, good to see you. And Steve, fantastic. Good to see you all in. Today, I've been tasked with the challenge, should I say, and I like a challenge, of talking about five things that make probably mean you're a better guitarist than you thought. And of course, you know, there's lots of stuff online and, you know, tuition about, you know, improve this, be better at that, and all that good stuff. But I think today is more of a celebration and taking into account of things that we may already be able to do, and some virtues that we may naturally already have and we can sometimes easily overlook because we're so kind of focused on striving towards a goal. So without further ado, it's been a tricky one to think of, but hopefully we can kind of come up with some kind of a line of thought. There's no particular order to this, and I wouldn't say, you know, this is, I was talking to Stuart Shields, our friend here at Lick Library, about, you know, kind of how we approach this topic today. And you know, this applies to all different levels. You know, it could be if you've just started out and you've, you know, maybe got a few chords under your belt and you're maybe working towards playing a song. Or you might be playing for many years and maybe you've become a bit kind of tired about your playing. Hopefully today we can give you some kind of positivity to fuel your playing and passion for music. So let's dive in. We have several different points, and as I go through, you know, if there's any questions relating to any of these, because inevitably all this will bring up certain topics in your own playing, for your own journey. So I'm happy to sort of dive into those as we go. So if there's any questions, please feel free to write them in the chat. And also, if you think I'm missing anything here, do write that, maybe save that towards the end, because we've got a few points to get to first. So first thing is, I would say if you're feeling a sense of confidence in learning new songs, and now this could be anything. For example, I remember when I started playing guitar, you know, I was presented with the C major chord. That's a cool chord. I was also presented with a G and a D. I think I had an E minor in there somewhere. And I remember even before, you know, that just to have those chords was a huge step for me. You know, it probably took about a year before I could even kind of just pick up the guitar and make the shape. Now, let alone the strumming. But before that, I had no idea what those chords were. I had to develop the calluses. I had to understand, at least in my own, I was probably about 6 or 7 at the time, but just kind of my own way, the order of, you know, the strings and how to kind of think about that. So that is, you know, that first of all was just information. But when I started to play songs, I started to really enjoy it, and naturally I got better at playing those chords. And then I was able to recognize those chords in other songs, and then it made it quicker for me to learn those other songs, you know. I remember the dreaded one for me was the F chord with the bar, and still today I avoid it. I even avoid that. I can't do the thumb thing, but just the top four strings is good enough for an electric player like me. So, you know, having a bit of confidence towards you know, approaching new things, and it might be that you actually get quicker at learning things. Now, one, you know, when I was thinking about bringing up these points, one of the kind of the yin and yang of this, the kind of the dark side of this, can be that when we're learning songs, we always think, right, I need another song, and I need to get to the pinnacle of the mountain. You know, today I learned how to play Knocking on Heaven's Door, and tomorrow I'm going to learn the main guitar solo for Sweet Child of Mine. And that's just, you know, it's a huge step between those two worlds. That's kind of an exaggeration, but we can be like that. We can sort of, you know, overstep the mark. And I'd say there's no better thing to do than to kind of live with the simple stuff, and something I still relish today. And you know, 95% of popular music doesn't require an awful a lot of, like, you know, kind of crazy fretboard knowledge or anything to at least be able to play the song. So actually going into simple songs and learning them, it's fun. It's fun to play simple songs, you know. I had friends back when I went to college who would learn whole Green Day and Blink 182 albums, and some of that stuff was quite challenging with the picking and stuff, but like it was just, you know, three or four power chords, and they'd have a great time. And actually they improved and had so much more fun with their playing, and they were so much more confident to approach other things as well, because they had that that basis, that kind of resilience that had been built from learning the stuff they love and the stuff which was simple. And it's a type of humility as well, an ability to go, I'm just gonna get the good stuff down. And I often wish that I'd spent more time just working on simple melodies and things when I was first learning lead guitar. I was wanting to get to all the fast stuff very quickly, and in some ways that kind of, I'm glad I did it, but I wish I'd spent a bit more time going over the simpler stuff, I think, and my playing would have changed. I'm just gonna, if you're a Lick Library member, we have a thing on the website where you can actually search song lessons, and this is something I periodically do, because you know, Lick Library has a whole host of song lessons on the website, hundreds, like it's unprecedented. No one else has as many of these song lessons all taught proper note for note in front of you, like a real guitar tutor. And actually, if you use the, let's see if I get this up. If you use the filter, you can actually search for easy in the settings, and loads of songs come up. And you know, some of these songs here, there's a variety of artists. I've got Lenny Kravitz there, I've got Joan Jett, we've got System of a Down, all kinds of different, John Denver, there we are, Don Henley, Alien Ant Farm, Sum 41, Deftones, Danzig, loads of Nirvana. I think that's a must if you're a rock guitar player and you want to get, you know, the fundamentals of just basic like cool power chords and attitude. That's a great album to check out. But yeah, you can use the filter there at Lick Library, and you can actually kind of search for this. There we are, 337 potential songs you could learn in just the easy section. That's more songs than I can ever memorize. So there's plenty to go at. And it's just to kind of celebrate the fact that you can play some of those songs, I think is great. You know, it's a cool thing to be able to do. Just going to check in on the chat there. Cynthia should have confidence to pivot through challenges. And Cynthia's got a really good point. And that's my next point, actually. I'm going to bring that up. So she's written, should having the confidence to pivot through challenges a way of knowing one is better than what they may think? Absolutely. And that's, again, I've brought that under the title. I've written these down on my phone. You challenge yourself and you don't compare. You look at challenges as a way of just excitement. There's a curiosity. It doesn't actually feel like you're doing a challenge. You're just curious. Curiosity rather than challenge, I think, is a good word, because curiosity means you're looking, and when you're truly curious, you're not thinking about really what's going to be the end result. It's just kind of more of a, whoa, I've got to test this out. An example, I'm currently preparing a new classic albums course for Lick Library on Fleetwood Mac, and there's lots of finger picking on acoustic on the album, lots of Travis picking. That's something I've dabbled for like probably in my whole life for the total sum of 1 hour on that. So actually the challenge of this is it's humbling, right? But actually in doing it, you kind of forget about yourself and you just focus on the music. And then also from this, I know that if I'd put in 10 minutes a day on this, I get an immense feeling of satisfaction. And I also like seeing the process happening. I'm learning about my practice. I'm excited to see how my practice affects the outcome. I know that when I sit down and I practice, I'm stressed. It won't come out right. So I have to, it's almost like a meditation. You get 10 minutes. I'm going to focus on those two bars. I'm going to do it real slow. I'm going to make sure it's quality. And then it's just satisfying. Then I get lost in the listening and the connection, the guitar. And what was challenging and scary suddenly becomes more palatable. So I would absolutely agree, Cynthia, challenging yourself is definitely a sign that you're a better guitarist, because you're always going to be open to doing new things. Now, the kind of the related point there is that you no longer compare yourself to others in a, I'd say, in a more critical way. Rather, not in the terms of like, okay, I'm checking out the performance against the track and making sure that it's sounding good in time and you're matching as much as you can the quality of what's been played. But in terms of the self-worth, you know, some, I remember back in my more competitive days of guitar playing when I was a teenager, when a friend of mine brought in an Yngwie Malmsteen album, and there's a magazine with a lesson on a song, and he'd learnt the riff, and I was like, I love the sound of that. That sounds amazing. I want to learn that. But then I saw him playing it, and I was like, I need to learn that, and I'm going to show him, and I'm going to be the person. And that was a bad way, because I suffered through it. But if I just stayed with the, I love that riff, and I'm just going to see what I can get from it. You know, I'm going to learn it, even if I can't play it full speed, even if it's not got quite the attitude or the hair of Yngwie, I'm going to, you know, just enjoy it. Get to, and that kind of curiosity getting you in there and not having any ego about it, I think is a really good sign that you're probably going to be better, because that's going to influence your playing throughout. So there we are. So I'm just going to check in if that makes any sense. Cool. Yeah, so 2 points I've made there. So first of all, confidence in learning new songs. You recognise patterns, you've got your chords, you can play a few songs that you like. And you start to, over that time, develop a tool belt of knowledge in terms of chords, or maybe it's riffs, maybe it's playing of different tunings, maybe it's, you know, using a new technique you've never used before. You start to develop these things and it all kind of snowballs. You can't go from A to Z. You have to go A, B, C, D, E, F, G. And that's different for everybody, depending on their tastes and their, you know, time and all that stuff. So to take stock of what you can already play and look at the journey. And one thing I always say, and this is actually a guitar tutor thing, you know, pick up your guitar and play it the other way around. And just see, you know, I mean, if you've been playing for maybe 5 years or so, you know, and you do this, you're going to feel like, wow, that's, you're going to compare that and see that's very different. You're going to notice that was a, you know, how challenging it was to even get your fingers to follow what you said and what wanted to do, and then to recall the shapes and even to get the hands to work together is actually a huge thing. So taking stock of that. And then if you're open to challenging yourself and you don't compare yourself as much as you used to or would do, that's a good sign as well. So hopefully these are making sense so far. Another point is that you're able to, I mean, this is a general point. And like I say, I want to stress the point that there's no perfectionism here. There's no, I'd like this to be scalable. So, you know, this might sound like I'm sort of talking about being a professional musician, but I'm more talking about somebody who is just interested in guitar and music. And that is that you're able to adapt to different musical situations. And that means, you know, you have a versatility on the guitar, or at least an ear and a sensitivity to what's actually going on in the music and who you're playing with, or the backing track or whatever you're playing. And that might be also, you know, listening to the tone of what's been played, you know, and you might have if I do a sweep picking lick in the middle of a ballad, it might not translate unless it's a Dream Theater ballad. But, you know, that sort of thing, maybe picking all the notes might not be the most appropriate. Maybe I play more legato approach to playing a melody, or maybe using a full bar chord here with that tone doesn't quite work. Maybe I need to look at smaller voicings of the chord. Things like that, being versatile with that. And that comes with the having learned lots of different songs as well. You know, I also say, you know, I've noticed in myself in the past and sometimes still when I'm not in the right mind state, you know, playing with people, playing music with certain musicians, and the kind of feeling of needing to prove something, to say that I'm here. It's a bit like you're kind of in a quiet car with people on a long car journey, then it feels awkward, so you just say something so people know that you've got control of the situation, but really you didn't need that control. So the same thing in a musical situation, kind of, you know, overplaying or doing something kind of that is a detriment to the song. Kind of saying, I'm here, I'm the one playing it. And so, there are moments for that, of course, but I think that musical sensitivity is something to be, it's a never-ending journey. But if you have even a sense of that, and you have a sense of that when you're listening to other players, if you like certain players or do that, I think that shows that probably You're a better guitarist than you think you are because you have an awareness. However, that being said, you can have all these thoughts, but the action is where it happens. You know, if you're able to actually deliver that, if you're able to say no to the voices in the head that say, do a tapping lick in this blues or whatever it might be, or show off that new chord. There's times for that, but there's a great Guthrie Govan video that's been going around recently, him talking about his martial arts instructor or friend who's a martial arts instructor. And Guthrie was saying, you know, I'd have lots of students come to me and they want to learn an Yngwie solo, but they probably couldn't play Michael Row Your Boat Ashore by ear. And he said, until they've got the first bit down, none of that crazy stuff is going to mean anything because they're going to have to think about it. They're going to have to really, you know, so I guess with this being said, there's this kind of embodied essence. There's less thinking and more doing in your playing after having done the thoughtful practice. So, yeah, a reasonable point to be made, I think. I hope this is making sense. Gosh. Where am I? Cool. So we've had confidence, challenging yourself, adapting to musical situations. And adaption means having internalized things enough so that it's more of a natural response rather than a forced thing. Having said that, some of this, I mean, guitar is difficult. You know, I mean, my improvisation at the start of the session, I probably wouldn't want to listen to that back personally, but you know, it's finding the joy. Like, this is fun. This is fun. I say this to my students sometimes when I'm teaching at the universities, and you know, sometimes it's a Monday morning and they're all a bit tired because I've had a long weekend as students. And I say, you know, this is, we're doing music. If you have time to pick up a guitar even once a week, like, that's amazing. Like, it's a privilege. It's a beautiful thing to be able to do. And if it makes you feel good, you're already a better guitarist than you think you are. Okay, another thing I'd like to talk about here. I hope this is a, summarise some points as well in the chat. I shall take a look at some of these comments as they're coming through. You're open-minded and patient with yourself. The eternal student is what I've written down. It's for people who are familiar with anything that I've done on my socials and Lick Library. I'm a big fan of Paul Gilbert. Absolutely love Paul Gilbert's playing. And what's been most inspirational about him is not only his playing, but like his philosophy and demeanor about music. It's fun. I've heard him in interviews say, you know, someone asked him, I think in that Rick Beato interview, like, you know, his barometer for if something's working is if he's having fun, you know. And that's where you can even challenge yourself and have fun, but you can also challenge yourself and have a really nasty time in your head. So having fun with that and being open. And he has a massive career behind him. He could easily be right, I'm done, guitar's complete, I've completed that, nothing else. But he's not. He's always learning new songs. He's learning sometimes the most simplest stuff, but he's loving it. He's paying attention to it. He's always looking for new stuff, and I love that. I mean, one of the reasons I take lessons from my favorite players all the time. I love jamming with people because you learn from people. And I don't even think it's necessarily jam with people who are better than you. I think that's always a good thing to do, but jam with anybody, because everybody is a mirror to what you're doing, and there's always something to be learnt. And if you think you're above that, there's a problem. So being an eternal student, being able to sort of put things down, there's the Zen saying. A university professor went to see a Zen master. I don't know if this is a real story, but it's probably been a thing. And he sits in front of his Zen master and he starts filling his cup with tea. The university professor is filling his cup up, the Zen master's filling the cup up for him, and he just lets it pour over, and the whole of the tea thing pours over, spills everywhere. And the professor's like, what are you doing? He's a crazy man, it's all going everywhere. And he said, your mind is like this cup, it is too full. You must first empty this cup to learn anything new. That's my paraphrase of it. There's probably a much more poetic way of putting it. But the idea of being open and receptive and open-minded is always going to mean you've got, like, challenging yourself, you're always going to be improving in your own way, not based upon somebody else's perfection or ideal, but in terms of your own thing. You're just, like, curious. Again, going back to the curiosity, you're open to trying things. And I was very lucky to have some fantastic tutors in my time who all embody that thing. And I think we should all try to find good influencers who nobody who thinks they're done yet. People who are always learning are always going to be the best teachers. I feel strongly about that. And also another question, just a slight point. Especially, I said this. Someone said this to me when I was stressing many years ago about my playing and stuff. And they said, "Well, what does it look like when you're happy with your playing? Like, what does it actually look like? What will it look like?" And you can only judge that upon what you know now and what you compare yourself to. And that changes anyway. You know, there's, and also, would you want to complete? I don't know. There's a certain sense of the slight struggle and the mystery of it, which keeps you going. If it was all too easy, then it would be no point in doing it at all, really. And it's not to say you play guitar for the sake of something being difficult, but just to relax that kind of like, I must complete whatever, you know, everything, because it's not going to happen anyway. Plus, there's only ever one you that's going to ever exist. So you might as well be the best version of that, and whatever that looks like, it's going to be different for different people. So there's no objective great guitarist out there. Cool. And finally, final point, I'm going to get to some of these points because people are making some great comments here. The final point I'm going to make here is you have more focus in your playing on groove, dynamics and tone. So this means that you're less preoccupied with everything that you can do, which is good. You need to have a good level of technique and everything. I think technique to serve what your purpose is, whatever that might be. It might be strumming, it might be picking, it might be whatever. But you're concerned about the sound and the quality more than the kind of the technical sort of scientism of it. You know, like you're aware of all the stuff on the fretboard. Hopefully you've got a good knowledge of some chords and you can tie that to some theoretical concepts which are useful for your writing or learning of songs. But ultimately that is forgotten, and you think about the timing of what you're playing. And timing doesn't have to be perfect, by the way. It doesn't have to be like a metronome, like quantized, but you have control of timing. You can go behind the beat, you can go forward of the beat. You can change the tone of what you're playing. You can kind of express something through your playing that feels like you're talking rather than you're just reciting information. And this is one of the reasons, one of the many reasons why I feel things like tablature are useful tools, but if that's the first thing you're learning music through before listening here, then you're going to miss the mark. You're just learning words for the sake of words. It's like a talking head or something. You're just saying stuff off of an auto cue. When actually what I'm saying now, even to the camera, is coming from, I don't know, but it's felt, it's meant, there's an intention and there's a thing. So if you find yourself more in that headspace when you're playing, that's good. And that dynamics and tone go into that as well. You know, you're not just hammering away with whatever tone will work. You'll be sensitive to the context of the song. And you'll also listen to music with a bit of that kind of in mind if you're doing more active listening. And a good remedy for this, actually, I think something that's beneficial for us all is, playing music which you need sensitivity for. And of course, that's subjective to your taste, but there's, you know, learning something like a Jeff Beck lick or playing along to like a Gary Moore ballad or, you know, just picking up Fleetwood Mac. I'm learning lots of Lindsey Buckingham solos. And some of those solos only use barely any fretboard, really. But there's so much intent and there's so much subtlety in the way he flicks the finger on a string and the way he builds things up and the way he ad-libs certain phrases and the vibrato and the intensity. There's a whole world, and that doesn't really require, you know, anything virtuosic. It just requires keen listening and attention to that sort of thing. So with that being said, I'd like to go back to Lick Library again. Another feature we have here at Lick Library, if you're in a membership, we've got tons of backing tracks. And again, if you're Love that, you know, certain places you can search for things, but here you can actually get, you can choose by scale, tempo, and keys. And these are guitar jam tracks, so these are kind of generic things you can sort of jam along to, which have been created by some of the awesome tutors at Licklibrary. We've got Mitch Laddie there, got Jack Gardner. Love Jack, fantastic player. Tom Quayle. I mean, this is just what comes up first of all. Of course, you can keep on going. There's lots of tracks to check out, but slow backing tracks, I would say, you know, learning to actually, you know, we're all such in such a rush to play. And one thing I practice, actually, I'm going to do a bit of playing for a moment because I'm talking a lot. But I try to do 5 minutes a day of scale wandering in time with, I don't have a drum loop set up, but, you know, I might just go for a walk on the guitar with whatever pattern I might happen to start with. I'm not kind of going in a sequence there. Some stepwise stuff, triads, whatever it is. But what I noticed is it's a good barometer to where my mind's at, because if I'm starting to, you know, I do it at a tempo where I have to keep it even, and that shows me if I'm rushing or dragging. And normally I'm trying to get warmed up, but actually this kind of relaxing back and keeping it even and connected, you know, that leads me to a much more relaxed and fulfilling way. And then when I want to play fast, because I've practiced the fast stuff, it generally comes out a bit better, fingers crossed, or whatever it might be. But I'm kind of saying hello to the guitar in a bit more of a kind of compassionate way, should we say. So there we are. So that's the 5 points. Let me just shall we summarize those, and I'm going to get to some of the questions. So how are we doing? So confidence, you've got some confidence in learning new songs. And it can be easy songs. You just get excited about learning songs. You start to recognize patterns. You know, E minor, I know that one. Good. You know, I know that position. Oh, that lick reminds me of that Richie Blackmore lick. Oh, it's just a bit different. I'll spend some, you know, there's a confidence. It's not like, oh, that's completely out of your, whatever your relative range is. And alongside that, you're curious about challenging yourself, because you're excited about things that will challenge you, going into new areas of your playing. And it's from an attitude of curiosity rather than I must conquer this to be better than the next person. So there's within that, you know, not comparing yourself. Keeping open-minded, presence and patience, and being the eternal student, you know, never assuming it's all done. What does it look like when you've completed guitar? And are you happy? Those are the two little pointers. Are you happy from Paul Gilbert? And you know, what does it look like when you complete guitar? Well, it'd be boring, wouldn't it? So it's good to have a bit of a challenge. Good to be open-minded. You're always going to be improving. You're able to adapt to different musical situations. So you have a kind of more of a part player mentality to music, rather than it all being just about ourselves, even though it is kind of about ourselves. Really, it's music. So the ability to step back and listen. And then alongside that, you know, being able to focus on groove, dynamics and tone. I'd say that is a very useful thing. And playing on slow backing tracks, learning to play lines and songs from emotive people kind of gives you into that connected thing. And like I said, with the warm-up there, just kind of taking your time, getting connected and in time with something like a drum loop or backing track. But, you know, kind of freeforming. Let me just demonstrate that as an exercise. I'll just take that backing track. This is not musical, by the way. I'm not pretending this is music, so keep that in mind, but it might just be. So many melodies come in. You know, I'm just trying to focus on the connection and the feeling of the notes. And it's a beautiful exercise to do because it's improvisational. And like I say, when you start running the scale and you're listening to it carefully, suddenly you start to hear, oh, I don't necessarily want to go to that next note. You start to develop the No, I want to. You start to actually get the improvisational aspect, and it's a bit of an ear training, and also fretboard. It's my hippie way of practicing guitar. It does ear, and it does fretboard, and it does technique. You know, you got sight, sound, and sensation. The three main ways we learn. Anyway, cool. So I'm going to just go to some questions now, if that's okay. I hope this has been somewhat useful. I'm just going to go through some of these. Rebel the Uncanny says, eternal student me. Fantastic. Noel says, I love the Tom Quayle legato. Thank you very much. I owe a lot to Tom. His tuitional stuff is fantastic. There's forgotten the name of the course at Licklibrary, Modern Legato for Beginners. Just such a good course. And then, of course, there's the advanced. He does the 51 legato licks as well. And there's stuff in there I can't play, but I like to give it a go. And just giving it a go, again, curiosity, because I just like, wow, that's a cool idea. And I wouldn't necessarily want to like take that lick and just put it in a song, but just a very like practicing of the line gets it into some muscle stuff, and everyone's better off for it. It feels good, sounds cool, and I've practiced a bit of technique. And if something comes out of my playing in 3 months' time, great. If something doesn't, no worries. I've had a good time anyway. Mark says, improvement comes so slow for me, I feel, always wanting to be faster. And that comes down to really, you know, your personal, I think just to establish what you can do already, make a note of that. Just write down every song you've learned, everything. You could be, if you really want to be pedantic, you could literally, I know this chord shape and this position. I can recognise these notes on the fretboard. Take a stock of it. And then think, well, hold on, this is all just ideas and can't, you know, these are things, but also like, what's the rush? What is the actual rush? Are you, there is pressure if you're looking at learning a song for a gig, for example. But then again, there's the curiosity. You learn about yourself, you learn about your practice. And I don't mean this towards Mark at all. I mean this towards myself in many ways. I've noticed when I've approached my practice in a very kind of, I want this now kind of attitude, the impatient attitude. And it always leads to kind of a kind of not really enjoying playing guitar, because there's always some imagined somewhere in mind, which as we've established, there's nowhere to go. You're arriving in life right now. There's no future, no past. And this moment is also just, whatever you make of it, your life is your attention. So, you know, what you're trying to do fast, just take your 10 minutes, whatever you're working on, just enjoy it. Don't worry. If you enjoy it, it starts to feel good. You start to enjoy practicing. You start to want to pick up the guitar. You start to want to work on things that are challenging, and you're not too bummed out when it doesn't, you know, because it can be difficult and, you know, it becomes hard to pick up and all that stuff. I'm just going to take a look at this. Timothy makes a great point. Sometimes you've been playing off for many years and you learn lots of new skills. Sometimes you feel you're not improving, but one day I noticed I've improved. And I think that's that mountain analogy. Like you look at a graph and it's going up. But if you zoom in, you'll see little peaks and troughs. But generally, you're always adding to your playing. The only thing that might feel like you're going backwards is some days, you know, we're tired. Some days, you know, we're just not in the right mindset. Some days our brains are just still processing that thing, and rather than forcing them in a kind of, I had a roommate back at uni and he used to scream at his hands. He's an amazing guitar player, but I don't think it's because he screamed at his hands, but I did hear him one going, ah! and I probably did that too, to be honest. So we have that attitude and it's like, no, take care of it. You can't force a tree to grow. You know, it just happens. Cool. Open-mindedness. Do you think listening and visualising should go hand in hand? Yeah, that's Cynthia's point. I think they kind of do. When I'm playing a melody, maybe I might work on like, so have like an intention. Sometimes I'll try and sing something and I can't sing anyway, but like, I might not get it, so then I might sort of work where that was. There we are. So, you know, you kind of work on that. But eventually, great Alan Watts talk, he talks about subject and object, outside world appearing in consciousness, and then you being in the world as a result of the world. And it says it's like a cork bobbing on water. You know, does the water move the cork, or does the cork let itself be moved by the water? And I think that's the analogy for visualizing the fretboard and listening. It's kind of a connection. And that's why learning by ear, learning licks by ear, is so important, because it connects you completely to the instrument. Or if you are going to use tab, which I can understand is useful, because you know I use it occasionally, but it never lasts and it doesn't go in. And if I go to the tab first of all, I'm not really learning anything musical. A little challenge, if I may, if you're listening to the radio or something in the car when you're driving and you hear something you like, a melody, see if you can retain it in your mind until you get home and pick up the guitar, and then see if you can figure it out. And even if you don't get it right, you've still used your internal ear and connected it to the fretboard. That's quite a cool thing to practice, you know, because it's active. You're retaining melodic information, because that's where it comes from. It doesn't necessarily just come from the guitar. It's a kind of both things happen at the same time, hopefully. So hopefully that makes sense. Or I might be just talking absolute rubbish, which is very likely. I love this sense of accomplishment from learning new songs, but also gets into another player's head. Absolutely, yeah, great point. So there's a sense of accomplishment, right? And I see myself as a musical archaeologist. I'm so blessed with this job at Lick Library doing the classic albums, because you know, I get to learn some albums, and I not only have to learn them note for note, but have to get them together so I can teach them and break them down into things. But in that process, it's like you're uncovering some secrets, even though other people might be able to play the songs or whatever, and it might have been covered before. Your own journey of figuring it out is marvellous. I feel like Tomb Raider, or I don't know, Indiana Jones or something. It's just, it gets me excited and giddy about music. I see it in people like Rick Beato when he does, you know, inside the song. He's just like, check it out. And it's just like one guitar track, and it's just somebody going. But he's so excited about it, and I feel the same. You know, it's great. So let's have a look at some other questions or things. How do you practice grounding your musical ear in theory when you know what note will sound like, but you can't really tell why? That's a profound question, because it's they both, again, like the cork on the water, they both start to inform. If I hear, how do I explain this? If I heard, I mean, I've just played that, so it's kind of a bit of a back to front thing. But when I hear that in a recording, there's lots of times I don't figure stuff out perfectly, but I know where to go. I know. That's always the. I've got the sound of it and I know the pattern of it, but also I can sort of discern from. It helps kind of. There's less options to what it might be when you're learning it on the guitar, because you go, oh, that's just a minor third to the root. I don't know if I don't even think that though. I just go, okay, cool, got it, right. But because I know the theory, I'm not going. I'm not kind of searching, but that also has to be done. We have to go through a bit of searching at the same time, but the theory kind of gives you a ladder across the swamp. There's an analogy. A wooden board across the swamp. That's what the theory does. It just gets you through it in a bit more of a quicker, more understandable way, and you've got a clear route back and forth, meaning you can take that idea, use it in your own playing, recycle it, do it in different positions. Less memorization of just numbers and more just hearing and feeling. So theory, of course, is all just a map. It's not the territory. The London Underground isn't just a bunch of straight lines doing this. There's curves, there's rock, and there's parts of it are not used anymore. But on the maps, London Underground maps, they're all very clean lines going around, you know, just so it's easier to kind of understand, oh, that's kind of what it looks like. But in the reality of music is, that's it. But the theory helps. helps you recognize. So Lewis says, I've recently broken through the intermediate barrier this past year, and I've wanted to ask, how do I get better at chord tone soloing without videos telling me what chords are playing? So you can, I mean, this is where theory does help a bit, because you can recognize a chord progression. Have I got? C, G, A minor, F. If I heard that in a pop song, I kind of, depending on the key, kind of get there fairly quickly. If you don't know that, maybe it's good to get the diatonic chord harmony down, but like the, figure out the chords, sit down and figure out what the chords are. That's you know, that's a good 5 minutes, 10 minutes spent just even getting the first chord. Discern what key it's in. And then go about limiting yourself to a place on the fretboard. So you can start to, that's another one actually, see if you can keep the chord progression going without any backing track. That's quite a good one. I don't know if that helps, but you'll certainly feel more connection, and you'll start to recognize chord progressions repeat all over different songs. And you go, this is why the theory of knowing a major scale helps, because rather than it being a, what chord progression is that, it becomes, it's most, unless you're playing like jazz fusion, not even trad jazz, but jazz fusion, where it can be quite random, or more soundtrack based stuff or things like that, you find there's some odd movements, but most people are doing very similar chord progressions. But the point is that they're doing them in their own way, and they're doing them with their own dynamic and groove and all that stuff. Hopefully that answers your question. Let me know. I probably need to wrap up in a moment. I'm just going to check out a few more of these. So more often than not, the first music I hear in the morning makes me want to play it. Fantastic. That's a beautiful place to be in. Great. Cool. Acoustic Fingers says something, and I want to establish this. Enjoying your playing very much. Thank you so much. It would be great to be better at guitarist than I am, though. And of course, you know, I'm not discounting here that we all don't want to improve, that we want to, you know, aspire to something. But I do think this kind of, one of the undercurrents, I think, in this whole live stream is just focusing on what good you already have available. Because we often look for the next trick, we often look for the next big thing, and in that search we get told, you know, here, 5 ways to optimize this and all this stuff, and you know, it's all useful stuff, but we have to be careful and kind in the way we take that on to our own journey in our playing. Otherwise it just becomes, you know, you're whipping yourself, and it just becomes not very fun at all. So Paul Gilbert, I think the fun question is good. Am I having fun with this? If it's challenging, if it's easy, it doesn't matter. Is this fun? The rest will sort itself out. I genuinely believe that. You know, if you're just playing, it also becomes established in your whole ethos. But if you're just learning to play guitar, to play some songs, then have fun. If you're learning guitar to be a professional musician, you still need to have fun. There's no purpose. You know, we're taught that we work to have fun, but why can't we just, you know, make work fun, you know, because, you know, focusing on the curiosity, and that provides us to have to ask some pretty serious questions about how we practice, what are we actually wanting from practice, who do we actually think we are. You know, I spent many years kind of having a very fixed idea of what I thought good guitar playing was, and that was actually my own downfall. It was useful at one point in my playing, and it can be useful sometimes as a reflection point, but I started to turn it into like a dogma that guitar had to be a certain way, and it had to be a certain era of playing, and it had to be this, and a tasteful lick sounds like this. And inevitably, when I failed to meet my own kind of parameters, it became very annoying. But as soon as I opened it up and realized, well, guitar is just a piece of wood with some metal, Jimi Hendrix and players like that started to revolutionize electric guitar in this case, and then eventually some other people like me came along and started saying, hey, this is using the cage system, and this is this, and it's all very useful and it's fascinating and it makes learning quicker. But you have to remember that the fundamental of this is people just want to play music, and express something, whatever that is, for no apparent reason other than to make music. You know, music was a thing before it became commercialized. People have used music to communicate and hang out. They used it to do all kinds of things. So it's kind of, if you have the luck, if you're lucky to play music, then, and you enjoy it, you're going to be better than you think you are. Okay, cool. Cynthia, I don't think there's such thing as a perfect guitarist. No, there's no such thing. Yet it is imperative that we, you know, the idea of perfection is an interesting one, and it is both inspiring, but I think it's changing. I mean, how many times have we heard a guitar player and said, "That's perfect"? Then we hear another guitarist and say, "That's perfect." But they're not anything like each other, and no one else is like them, and no one else is like you. So the most perfect thing you can be is imperfect, because that's just how nature is. It's just a cycle. It's there. It changes, constantly changes. Fashions come and go. But where are you in all of this? I think that's kind of what I'm coming to here. Cool. Hi, David. I'm wrapping up now. I've got one more question from Colin O'Hare. I'd like to answer this, and then I'm probably going to respectfully say good night, because it's been absolutely lovely hanging out. It's been great. Colin asks, "Hi Sam, been playing ninth chords, etc. C add 9. What makes the 9? Is it the ninth note in the scale? Just got me thinking about these things. So what theory should I seek?" So the ninth, if we just take a C major scale, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, then you could call the octave of C, in this case, the 8. We don't call it that, we just call it the octave. Now, technically the 9 is the octave of the 2. So in the key of C, the 9 is technically the 2. Now, the reason why it's called C add 9 is we already have a major triad in the chord. We've got root, third, fifth. And on top of that, we've got a 9 on there, a 2 added to the chord. It's not the same as a C dominant 9 or C major 9, because both of those will have the 7th in there in some capacity. And voicings get, we've got voicings, a different thing. But C add 9 is a major triad or a minor triad. C minor 9, C minor add 9. And it's different from a sus, because sus is where you suspend the third. So sus 2 would be root 2nd 5th, like that. Or you might have C 4, C sus 4. So an add 9 is where you add a second up an octave on top of your triad. That's kind of one way of putting it. You can also get add 11 as well, where you have a major triad. Or maybe you do a sharp 11 here. There we are, that's a nice chord to finish with. That's a C major 7 add 9, because I put the B in there as well. Anyway, hopefully that answers your question, Colin. I would look, if you're looking at more of a theoretical thing to start searching, I'd search about how extended chord formulas from the major scale. That might be a good research for you, just to kind of establish some of the formulas. And like I say, it's all a map. It's not the truth, but it's very useful. And I love it. It's fascinating. It's the mathematics of music. Cool. All right, Mark, good to see you. See you all. I'm gonna, cool. I'm gonna just check there's nothing else here. Perfection, if perfection could be attained, it wouldn't be worth having. That's a really good one. Yeah, it wouldn't be worth, that's it. Like I said earlier, you know, if you complete guitar, what does it look like? Well, you wouldn't play guitar anymore, probably. Cool, good to see you all. I'm gonna probably finish this up now, but if you have any further questions, this video will be left up, so you can always go in the comments once this is uploaded and leave a comment. And sometimes after, a few days after, I just check out if there's anybody with any other questions, and I'll get back to them in due course. But it's an absolute pleasure. I'll be back here very, very soon for another live stream. And if you look like, remember, check out those search functions. They're really cool. But enjoy your playing. You deserve it. Just have a good time. Yeah. Check out the Paul Gilbert interview with Rick Beato. It's really funny. And it will inspire you to play guitar. Absolutely. Anyway, good night. Here's a C add 9.